5 panelists, 5 topical issues, no holds barred.
For me, it's not knowledge that's lacking. It's that greed, it's that mentality where you feel you deserve to take your own and take it infinitely and let everybody else just manage however they will manage.
We're almost becoming hardwired to try and cheat. I would, you know, suggest that we begin to hold our leaders accountable.
There was a time in this country when things actually work.
I don't think that any organization should be above the law. And I think one of the challenges we have in this country is about governance across the board.
Well, what I'm saying is that it doesn't really affect us in Nigeria.
I don't know what we can do if the system is already corrupted.
We've been warned as a continent of the influx of the Chinese. If you don't repay your debt, they will just colonize you.
This may well be a time to reconsider the saying, he that wears the shoes knows where it pinches. Making lockdown easier on the poor. Some thoughts. Nigeria is way behind in citizens' database. Thus, the lockdown palliatives implemented in other parts of the world may be tough to cut and paste in our environment. For instance, there are less than 40 million BVN linked accounts. And inside of those 40 million are all our HNIs, the mass affluent and the middle class, who don't need free food kind of support. Most of the people who do don't even have bank account. However, in Lagos, we know where the poor lives and can get relief packages containing food items, soap, sanitary towel, basic drugs, etc., to their doorsteps a few days into the lockdown. There are clear neighborhoods in Lagos where we know 90% of the people who live there will need support during the lockdown. Ijara Badia, some parts of Bariga and Oworo, some parts of Ajegunle and Makoko, etc. We should deliver relief boxes at their doorsteps. In the same vein, most of the people who live in Face Me, I Face You homes are part of the lowest rung of the ladder and will require this support. Let there be packages for them too. In the more affluent environment, it is obvious that those guys living in the uncompleted and abandoned buildings will need support. By the look of a building, you can determine if the people living there will need help. Reach out to them. Trade associations know their members and can reach them. For example, NURTW leadership in a park know their members in that park. Work with them. There could be a provision for the elderly to come to neighborhood school premises where they can pick their packages. I learned Lagos State is doing something along this line using the Lastra database. But like all other databases, what percentage of Lagosians have done Lastra registration? We must think about that. Churches and mosques have a better knowledge and profile information of their membership. And quite a number of them have been involved in regular welfare reach outs for these members. This can also be a veritable channel for distribution of packages to needy members. We also need to have arrangements to be able to get people to hospitals should the need arise. We seem to have forgotten that before COVID, people do fall ill and may need urgent medical attention. But what happens if there is no transportation? Governments must fill this void by making ambulances available at each local government area and providing the citizens with the numbers to reach them for emergencies. How about the beggars and the homeless at this time? We know where they live too, and we can reach them there. We must avoid the kind of distribution we saw online in Lagos some days ago. The crowds were so uncontrolled that they may as well have been dancing in a petri dish of COVID-19. Any approach we adopt must keep eyes on infection control while reaching out to the needy. There are too many people who cannot feed if they don't earn in a day, and they don't have enough to stock up for 2 weeks. The lockdown must consider them.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. And I was discussing a similar, you know, thing with a journalist friend, and I said, look, why is it that we like this cut and paste approach to issues? The big words are, big countries are locking down. we also are cutting and pasting without also understanding the peculiarity of our circumstances. Lagos State Government wanted to lock down, but I listened to the Lagos State Governor and the Commissioner for Health, and their reason was that they didn't want to lock the economy also because hunger might even be more serious
than COVID-19.
And so what they were doing was, you know, advisory, and then ensure that, you know, some areas are on lockdown. But then the president just came, like military fiat, Lagos lockdown, Abuja lockdown.
Ogun State lockdown.
And for me, another thing is that we just fold our hands, we're folding our hands, waiting for the vaccine to come from the West. Is it a crime that we should also go into the lab and begin to look for the vaccine to the... Is it a crime that, the solution to this problem came from Africa?
There was a Professor Iwu solution.
You know, so
we're not... ignored.
We're not even looking at all of this. We are so fixated on the West, waiting for them, while copying everything that they did. Yet, we don't have the same infrastructure. So it beats my imagination. I listened to Ada Ahmed complaining. You stuck your home, and the very next day, there's no light.
Wow. Yeah.
Your generator cannot power your freezer. Yeah, so at the end of the day, all the stock, you have to cook all of them in one day. You know, so what's the essence? Mm. Government should look at this issue. That's why, for me, on running up on this, I had expected that the governors who understand the terrain and the people better should have been left to manage, you know, their states,
their affairs,
you know, according to the peculiarity of the state,
I'm not against the lockdown simply because I feel that if you've seen that it's worked, then let's not even make it a case of them versus us. If you've seen that it's worked, then it works. But my own issue is the palliatives. I don't think we've thought through the palliatives.
I don't think
so. If we think, like now you're saying, face me, I face you. I went to buy water in a face me, I face you enclosure. And I said to myself, sending these people home to stay here is tantamount to murder.
Because
I saw someone wearing face masks. I said, there's no running water in this environment. Mm-hmm. You're all on top of yourselves. What is this face mask actually going to do? You're condemning them.
Eight of them live in one
room. So if one person catches it, all of them, IDPs, all these people, they're really in a very dangerous place. So I just
think they use one latrine.
It's a case of sit down. You get the eggheads to sit down and say, okay, how do we deal with this? Because this is our existing situation. How do we make these people safer than they are? How do we make sure, even if we have to dig a borehole right now, make sure there's running water here, make sure there's, you know, they don't have to, because like you're saying, if people are starving to death, what life are you saving? So you know, I'm not against the lockdown because I think it's been proven to have worked and we needed to stop it. The figures are going up in Lagos particularly. We needed to just say, look, everybody just stay in one place. But staying in one place is now becoming more dangerous.
I am not saying don't lock down. Sorry, quickly. I'm not saying don't lock down. Mm. But the people that are closer would understand the peculiarity
of how to
Lagos
about
was
it.
Locked down even before the
official
military
lockdown. Yeah.
You know, it was locked down, but there were some areas, some businesses that were operating skeletally. Mm. And so to avoid that hunger and that crisis, that epidemic, you know, of having everybody, imagine in a face me, I face you, of 18 rooms, all of them sharing one latrine. And all of them are at home.
And then they're giving messages like clean,
social distancing,
clean after you.
And wash your hands.
How does that work?
And there's no water. And there is no water.
Anyway, if Nigeria doesn't change with this COVID-19, I don't think it will ever change.
No, it will change.
First off, responding to Gbolahan's advocacy, it shows us more than ever before the need for data management. The results of our census of time past. And the fact that we need to apply this thing. Some of the food packages distributed were distributed on party lines. I saw it coming.
Oh, really?
I saw it coming.
Yes, yes.
But we know where the poor lives.
So
that
even
is
now,
my
we're still
which
doing,
is the point
still
you have
doing,
made.
Yeah.
We're still doing
this
the same
partisan
thing. We must stop this partisan, the party people at the grassroots.
As I told you,
collecting
people who are
collecting
to only their members, and the members are purely tight.
No,
terrible.
We must rise above this. We must begin to look at how many people are in a local government. This is a time for local governments to have meaning and relevance.
Yes, we need to know local government.
Right?
Yes.
If we're distributing based on local government allocations, which is the biggest local government in Lagos, for instance,
Alimosho,
the smallest, they can't get the same thing. The ward level. How many people are in these different wards? We need to return to the census.
What is the role of the local government chairman
and the councillors?
Yes.
That remind me, I must quickly give kudos to my own councillor.
Please give. Let's hear some good news.
He has, you know, what he did was, you know, he reached out to the, you know, people who could fairly do well in the local government, and then he's been able to put food together, and distribute to
the poor. That's fantastic.
You know, he's been consistently
that's a
doing that.
Pressure.
You know,
call his
so
name
take,
out.
Take from
that would be a campaign.
No, I don't mind.
It's not a party
thing.
It's
individual stuff. Because for me, a country is only as strong and as stable as its weakest. So if the vulnerable people are not being taken care of,
truly, my counselor in Jeremy Feludum, it's doing that exceedingly well.
Please, other people should hear.
He's the Koshofe majority leader, and he's been doing that.
Absolutely refreshing to hear that. We must do more, and we must now begin to pay particular attention. You talked about Lastra. We still must come back to data management. How do we manage our people? How do we provide the basic infrastructure? Our politicians, do your constituency, is there water there? Is there water? Do you know the number of people you have? If you're going to make an intervention, how do you make an intervention?
Without data.
You say data. Without data.
It's all about data. We are the voice of the voiceless. As you join your voice to ours, the message is amplified. Do keep your comments coming in on Facebook, plus TV Africa, hashtag The Advocate NG, or on Twitter and Instagram, at Plus TV Africa, hashtag The Advocate NG. To catch up with previous broadcasts, go to plustvafrica.com/theadvocate. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel, Plus TV Africa. Till next week, same time, same channel. Let's keep advocating for a better society. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Let's stay safe.
Five panelists, five topical issues, no holds barred.
For me, it's not knowledge that's lacking. It's that greed, it's that mentality where you feel you deserve to take your own and take it infinitely and let everybody else just manage however they will manage.
We're almost becoming hardwired to try and cheat. I would, suggest that we begin to hold our leaders accountable.
There was a time in this country when things actually work.
I don't think that any organization should be above the law. And I think one of the challenges we have in this country is about governance across the board.
What I'm saying is that it doesn't really affect us in Nigeria.
I don't know what we can do if the system is already corrupted.
We've been warned as a continent of the influx of the Chinese. If you don't repay your debt, they will just colonize you.